Ever wonder how to add a feature or role to Windows Server? Scratching your head, not sure where to go and what to do? I'm gonna clear it all up for you and show you two distinct ways you can do it. All that and more, coming up now. Hello everybody, welcome back. My name is Adam Gordon, an entertainer here at IT Pro TV, coming at you with another exciting and fun-filled episode on what you can do with Windows Server. We take a look at different tasks, everyday operations, and in general, just things that often make people scratch their heads because they want to know how to do them, but they're not sure the best way to get the job done. We're going to take a look at how to actually add either features or roles to your Windows Server installation, and there's two distinct ways we can do that. One is from the command line via PowerShell. One is from the graphical interface from the Server Manager. We'll demonstrate both, and we can do this across Server 2016, Server 2019, and or brand new Server 2022. I'm going to show you how to do it in Server 2022, but remember, everything we show you in these episodes is available to you, works the same way, can be done exactly the same across all three versions of Server. Join me here if you will. We'll take a look at a Server 2022 virtual machine that I have set up and running. And we're going to go ahead. We're going to begin by taking a look at how we can add a feature or a role and do so from PowerShell, from the command line interface that allows us to maybe script this activity out if we want to automate it, as opposed to having to be in front of the computer clicking buttons in an interface. But I will show you how to do both. So what we're going to do is just quickly remind you of where we can go to find PowerShell. We go to our Start menu. Depending on the version of PowerShell that you may have installed, if you're using the default version built into Server 2016, Server 2019, or Server 2022, you'll find it located right there, highlighted in the square that I'm pointing to, under the Windows Server menu over there on the right. And you can use that, and that, as long as you load it as an administrator, I'll show you how to right-click and do that momentarily. You can use that version of PowerShell, whether you choose to update it or not, is fine. It will work, and the commandlets I'm about to show you are supported in the older version of PowerShell. This is a 5.x version, the current default version that ships with Server. But if you want the brand new, absolutely latest version of PowerShell, PowerShell Core, you can go ahead and run PowerShell, currently version 7.something, and you have to install that separately. So you'd have to install that from the download site. And once you do that, you'll find a shortcut for it, typically right at the top of your Start menu. You can also go down to the folder right down here where it says Windows PowerShell in your Start menu and find the different versions of PowerShell installed there. Whichever version you want to use, simply right-click and choose under the More option, Run as Administrator. That way you have full administrative rights available to you inside of the PowerShell session. I've done that already, and I've chosen to go ahead and use the PowerShell 7 instance, PowerShell Core. You can see I'm running it as an administrator up there. That way we're using the latest version. And all I've done to modify it, unlike what you'll see when you start PowerShell, is simply make the console font size big enough so you can see it. I've made it into a 20-point font using Lucida Console as my font, just so it's easy for you to see on the screen. Other than that, it will look identical to what you're going to see when you launch PowerShell on your machine. All right, having said that, there's two or three different commands, depending on what we want to do, that are helpful here. I'm going to show you each of them in turn. I'm just taking the liberty of writing them down, spelling them out so you can see them nice and clearly, and I could simply copy and paste them into PowerShell as we use them. If you want to find out what the current status is of the features that are installed, and whether they are enabled or disabled before we choose to go poking about and trying to turn them on and off, it's probably a good idea to get a listing of them. And we could do that with the Get Windows Optional Feature commandlet. You'll see it highlighted right there. And by specifying that we want to use the dash online parameter, we could see all of the ones that are currently in the system and what their status is, whether they are enabled or if they're not available, they are disabled. So just going to go ahead and paste that in. I'm going to go ahead, hit enter. Now it does take a moment to kind of interrogate the Windows Server, get back all of the settings for all the different optional features. There are many of them, and then to display all that on screen. So be patient. You can see it takes about 30 seconds to report back. And then we get a list that tells us the name of the feature, whatever it may be, and its current state, whether it's enabled or disabled. And we seem to have a mix of both as we take a look. And if we scroll back up all the way to the top of the list, and it is a long list, as you can see, we will see that we have a mixture of both, and we could see that that executed with no trouble. Let's just go down back to the bottom there. And let's just clear our screen. CLS clears our screen for us. And now that we've kind of established what Windows optional features are there, and let's pretend we picked up on one that we would want to be able to enable. Maybe it's not turned on right now. It's set to disable. Then our second command would become important. The enable Windows optional feature commandlet allows us to turn on or enable that feature. We have to use the feature name parameter. So we want to target a specific feature. We have to provide the name, in this case, direct play. You would just simply substitute in the name of the feature that you want to enable. Put that inside quotes so it's treated as a literal string, so we know it is going to represent that name. If the name was direct space play, you would have a space in there. The quotes allow us to do that. And then parameter dash all, enable any and all of the dependent features that may rely on, or that direct play relies on, I should say, to ensure that it is fully functional as we enable it. So it's important to note that. All right, so we're going to go ahead, we're going to copy this, just Control C to copy, and we're going to go ahead, going to come over here, just paste that in, and notice the minute I do that, it starts running, and you'll see your little yellow dialog area comes up, enables probably in about 15 seconds, doesn't take too long, and we get back some information that says online true, restart needed false. We don't have to restart for that to become enabled. Good to know. And we're set to go. Now we've turned that on. Whether we want that one or not is obviously an important consideration. But if we want to do the same thing but in reverse, instead of enable, we want to disable. Let's say, you know what, I didn't really mean to turn that feature on. I want to turn it off. Well, I can do the same thing just by simply saying disable Windows optional feature. Again, feature name parameter. What feature am I targeting? I'm going to go ahead and copy that. And I'm going to go ahead, paste that in, hit enter. You'll see it is now disabling instead of enabling. Notice the restart needed. Still set to false, but now we know that that has been turned off. And so now we're good to go in terms of how we might do this from a command line, from PowerShell. A couple of simple commands, nothing too complicated. You obviously need to understand what the name of the feature is that you might be targeting, so you would want to think about that and keep that in mind. But other than that, you can easily enable and disable features, and we could easily, just as easily, enable or disable roles as well if we chose to do that. Let's take a look at how we would do the same thing, but do so from the graphical interface, from what we call Server Manager. Now, Server Manager loads by default on most Windows servers, so it would normally be up and available, looking just like this. But if you weren't, for some reason, seeing it, you had to go to the Start menu. You could do that. You would come right over here, and in that same area where we see PowerShell, we see the Server Manager. You could simply click on that tile to load it up. And it takes about 30 seconds to a minute to come up and check the status of all the services and kind of be ready to go. Once we've done that, we're going to come over here, and you'll see right up at the top in the right-hand corner, you can see a list of tools and capabilities that are available to us that currently exist. And to the left of that, we have Manage. And Manage is where we're going to go to be able to add or remove roles and or features. So we're going to click on Manage, and you'll notice that when we do that, we do have a shortcut menu that pops out. Adding roles and features is very simple. We just click on the appropriate area. Or if we want to remove something that's already been added, we can do that as well. We're going to go ahead and choose Add Roles and Features. So we launch this wizard here. Let's just minimize, whoops. Let's just minimize and center that. There we go. And the wizard tells us that there's just some information we want to be aware of before we begin. Really not important for us when we're looking to add features or roles, but just so that you know, we can verify tasks that are completed as they run through the wizard. We may be able to close out of the wizard at a certain point without waiting for tasks to complete. That kind of information is shared with us on the first screen. All right, so we're going to click next. We are then going to make a choice here about the installation type that we want to engage in. You'll see here role-based or feature-based install, meaning configuring a single server, this server, the local server we're on, by adding roles, role services, and/or features. Or do I want to do this through a remote desktop services installation. A little bit beyond what we're talking about here, but we're going to stick to what we're doing on the local machine and not worry about setting up role services to support the use of what's called VDI, virtual desktop infrastructure, and allow remote sessions to be managed through and or against this or other machines. So we're going to leave the default in place, click Next. We then have to select which server we want to manage. The default is the local server, the machine we're on that we're running the server manager from, but I could actually connect out to another remote machine somewhere else on my network. And if I have administrative rights, I'm able to connect to that machine. It's in my network, part of my namespace, and I have rights to it. I could use this server manager to remotely do what I'm about to do against other machines without having to necessarily be in front of them and connected to them physically, right? Sitting in front of them as opposed to connecting to them remotely. So just want to point that out. We're going to stick with our local machine, so we're going to leave the default there. We then first see that we have access to the list of server roles, and we would then select by checking off one or more of them and following the wizard and the additional steps to configure whatever our choices may imply. We would then see features if we choose not to do any server roles or do server roles and walk through the configuration, but the order goes server roles and then features and then confirmation. So we could choose a role out of here if we chose to, perhaps something like, the web server, IIS, so we can host web pages. And you'll see there happen to be some features that the installation of IIS requires. And the logic here is that those dependencies are known and they're triggered in the tool when we make a choice. And as a result, we're prompted to go ahead and add those features directly without having to go to the features list and know which ones we need to select. Well, we like that logic because it means a foolproof installation and it means everything should come out with the right amount of information available, the right features installed, the right dependencies loaded, so that our system should be functional and we're not having to worry about fixing a bunch of stuff before we can actually use it. So we like that capability a lot. So we've selected there. If that's the role or roles we're good with, we'll click to features. We may want to add additional features separate from the ones that we've just configured specific to IIS, or we've chosen to add and configure specific to IIS. And so as we scroll down, if we choose to add any additional things here, whatever they may be, we can simply go ahead and put those in. Let's go ahead and let's add the TFTP client. We can make any choice we want here as long as it makes sense for us. And then we have some configuration for the role. And this will vary and depend. It's totally dependent on the particular role that we've selected, in this case, the web server. So there's going to be some configuration of role services. So a little bit of documentation, information about what we're about to do and see. We then have to go in and make some choices or perhaps accept the defaults and leave them in place for the current default configuration of what an IIS web server would look like. And we see a bunch of stuff is selected, and we have the opportunity to add some additional stuff, as you can see, depending on what we choose to do. You could see I'm just adding some things in there. And then when I'm done, go ahead and click Next. Then it gives me a list of all the different things that I've chosen to install, ask the system to configure. If I do want the machine to restart automatically, if required, without prompting me, I could check that box off. If a restart is required, the server does so automatically. It will not prompt me. It just goes ahead and does that. Good for remote systems that we're not sitting directly in front of, that we have to manage. We want to have that restart done without a human being there to push the button. So that's a good feature, something to consider. But keep in mind, we lose connection to that server when it restarts, and we have to have a way to get back into it once it's up and running. So just keep that in mind. We'll click Yes. Nothing we're doing is going to require a restart. We'll click Install. Now it's just going to go ahead and start the installation. And I mentioned that Microsoft is good about telling us when we can stay in the window and need to be here or when we can leave. It says, hey, you can close this wizard. You won't interrupt any running tasks. We could go ahead and simply exit out, go on about our business now. If we want to see a notification or a status update, we can always open this page up again and look to see what's going on. Or we could simply wait here. It'll take just a couple of minutes to finish, and then we'll be able to see that this is done, and we'll be able to close out of here. We're not going to wait around for it to finish because it could take several minutes, but you can see it's really not all that complicated. The hardest part is making the appropriate choices on the menu, figuring out what role services and or features we actually want to target for installation during any given cycle as we go in. All right, we're going to close out of here, let that finish up. When it's done, we'll be able to see that there'll be a change here. We'll see IIS will pop in, so we'll know that it's been installed. And we'll also see under tools that we'll see some information about managing IIS made available there, so we can visually tell that that installation is finished. So when you need to install, configure, and or modify, perhaps even remove existing installations of roles, role services, and or features in Windows Server, we have several options. You can use the command line via PowerShell. We can go in and use the Server Manager, what I call the GUI interface, and either or both will let you do the exact same thing. The only difference is, do you prefer pushing buttons or do you prefer typing those things in and maybe automating them at scale? Both of them allow you to connect remotely to other systems you have rights to manage, and both of them will give you feedback about whether you were successful or not, as you saw, based on the current status of the installation before you begin whatever tasks you're looking to target. All right, well, we finished another perfectly good episode about how to optimize and really get the most out of your Windows Server experience. I'm going to wish you happy Windows Servering, and I'm going to see you soon.